In the name of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let me see you. In contemporary society, where self-fulfillment, accomplishment, personal enrichment, and enjoyment are the goals sought by the majority, it seems inconceivable that people would willingly sacrifice, suffer, and be humiliated so that others would benefit. Yet in the 20th century alone, there have been many people whose unselfish example and willingness to subjugate self for the needs of the whole have transformed individuals and nations. Look at the city of Houston. As we sit comfortably here in the sanctuary, the rescue team is still at work, saving thousands of people in Houston. We have seen and heard the heroic efforts of selfless people taking care of others. This is where America is at its best. It is going to take months or even years to get that city back to normalcy. I would like you to look at the gospel lesson from this context. If we are really honest, we have to admit that Peter speaks for all of us. And he rebukes Jesus for saying that he would soon suffer and die. The main reason Peter does not do this is the following of God of suffering will also make him suffer. And he was right. Those who want to be my followers, Jesus said, must deny themselves and take up their crosses and follow me. What Peter probably figured out right from the beginning was that he would have to sacrifice. And Paul carried it a step further. He said, we are called to be living sacrifices. Which may be one of the biggest problems that we face in our daily life. Sacrifice is not a word that we use on a daily basis. Think about when you use the word sacrifice last. And how do we use it, even if we use it? Come to think about it, there is only one sport, as far as I know, where the term is actually used. Do you know which sport that is? Of course it is, baseball. You can almost hear commentator announcing over the radio like this. And there it goes, a long fly ball to left, easy out, but the man on the third tacks up and drops home. Sacrifice fly. What a great idea. You are out, but you help someone else go around. Baseball is one of the few sports where you lose, but the team wins. Do you remember the way comedian George Carlin spells it out? In contrast between the hardness of football and the softness of baseball? In football, you tackle. In baseball, you catch flies. In football, you punt. In baseball, you bunt. Football is played on gridiron. Baseball is played on the field. In football you score. In baseball you go home. In football you kill. In baseball you sacrifice. Baseball may be the only sport that we hear this word sacrifice. It's one of the places where anywhere that you hear in a self-centered, take care of yourself, don't worry about anybody else's society. In contrast to football, sacrifice may sound like a sign of weakness, but I hardly think of any of the Atlanta Braves or Minnesota Twins are weak. Baseball is one thing, but life is another. Who sacrifices anything anymore in time like ours? Who really denies themselves, takes up crosses anymore? Actually, sacrifice can lead to bitterness, especially when you thought you were trusting God's plan for your life and suddenly you realize that you have to sacrifice all your greatest hopes and dreams as burnt offerings on the high altar of the providence of God. Yesterday I did a funeral in Westwood. I was standing here and the funeral director was a very, very well-informed man. He just called me aside after I spoke a few words and said, "Do you know this place is the richest place on the earth?" I said, "Why?" "This is one place full of fulfilled and unfulfilled dreams." I thought it was remarkable when I heard that. Who has the time to sacrifice? Who has the willingness to sacrifice? Here is a young man who wanted to be a lawyer, but his father died. And he had to leave school and work to keep things going at home. Here is a young woman who wanted to be a great doctor, but was never admitted to medical school. Here is a businessman who had hoped all his life to make his business a great success. But the competition was so much tougher than he expected that he soon found himself declaring bankruptcy. Here is a couple whose marriage is on the rocks. When it started, it was so sweet and good, but now it's not the same. There is not a single person in any congregation who has not sacrificed a hope or a dream as burnt offerings on the high altar of the providence of God. Here is where we find exactly how we deal with disappointments and unfulfilled dreams. That's when I read the passages from the scripture to find out for myself what it means to be dejected, disappointed, disillusioned. According to Paul in Romans 5, there's something about rejoicing in our suffering. Somehow we are called upon to rejoice in our suffering. We are called upon to really lift high that cross and fall. What happens when our hopes and dreams go up on burnt offerings and we do not know what to do? When the unexpected happens, what will you do? 22 years ago, I was in JFK Medical Center in Kennedy. Edison. And I was sitting there with a 16-year-old girl who was about to die. She was one of my parishioners. Parents were there. Can you believe? She's on her deathbed after 13 days of a simple surgery we call tonsillectomy. It's a routine procedure. But somehow a thought got into the site of the operation or the surgery, and that became infected. After 13 days, she died of septicemia. I'm standing with both father and mother very good friends of mine for years. They're members in my church for about almost 20 years. And I looked at them. There was this anger when she breathed her last. Father wanted to kill the doctor. It was totally negligent from the doctor. Somehow, somewhere, we were in the chapel trying to find some kind of answer to this problem. Mother wouldn't speak. Father was really, really mad. And we didn't know what to do. That particular time, the world had come to an end for that family. What do you say to such people when they go through such devastating experience? You know, you might have a degree in theology. That's when you have to throw your book out. No theology will work there. She was an athlete, just entered Rutgers University. So we stood there and we went home afterwards. I spent the whole night with the family. Every now and then when I was sitting with her father, he would hold my hand and say, "Can you say a prayer?" So I prayed all night. Every 10 minutes I had to pray. And I saw something at the funeral which they carried in their minds for probably almost 5 or 6 years. I just prayed a short prayer saying that God help us to deal with this impossibility of living after this incident. Help us to get over this impossibility that we are facing now. That sentence carried them all their lives. Now, after having gone through that experience, they are the first people in that parish to go to any funeral or when there is a death. Because they have something to say to the people who are grieving. Not the pastor. They had gone through that experience. And I realized that this is exactly what happens to us. When we are meeting with our disappointments and disillusionments, can that encourage us, propel us to do the impossible? How can we think of others in times of need and in our own disappointments? I would like you to look at our world at the moment. Is there a time that we have for others? Is there a time that we can spend fulfilling other people's dreams? I was hearing about the truth in the Middle East and how their morale was. I was reading about it and somebody went to the Fort Hood in Texas asking the chaplains a few questions. These were the questions that were asked. How do your troops feel about the fight? Are they ready to fight? The person wanted to know, we wanted to know because that seemed to be the prevailing mood in the country. And the chaplain said, no, they are not ready. They are very anxious and unsure. They knew that they may have to sacrifice their life for the country, or was it for our own way of life? Whatever the case, perhaps they too felt a sense of incompleteness. The country feels over Vietnam or any other country. And the chaplain said something very, very important that we need to take good listening to. Everyone loses in war. Everyone. we may have to let go of a lot of our self to be a follower of Jesus. When I was doing my graduate studies in Drew University in Madison, New Jersey, I had a friend. His name was Michael. Michael was really hard up for money. So he decided to work in a grocery store to support his education. He went to ShopRite in Morristown, and he was at the checkout counter. Every Saturday he used to go work all day. One day he came back and shared something with me. He talked about a very elderly woman who used to come regularly to buy things from that store. And Michael used to always be friendly with her. How are you? That kind of very simple questions. And the week before Thanksgiving, the store was full. Michael usually is on a checkout counter, which is an express counter. And she always comes to that particular counter with only four items: bread, egg, milk, very basic necessities. That day Michael was working, and she was standing in line. Unfortunately that day, Michael was given a general checkout counter. Huge line. At the back of it, she's standing with the four items. So Michael left the counter, went up to her, much to the annoyance of other customers, and said, go to the checkout, to the express checkout, you can get out easy. She said, don't worry about me. After about 20 minutes, she comes to the counter, and she pays the money. And Michael asked her, why did you stand in this particular counter? Why do you have to do this? You have been waiting for so long. And she said this, my dear young man, I come here every week. But when you hand over the change to me, you touch my hand. That is the only human touch I get every week. We may have to extend ourselves to touch, move, and inspire people. This precisely is taking of the cross and following. Not saying that my mother-in-law is the cross I have to bear. That's not what the cross means. That's a very wrong idea of the cross. It simply means, how much can we extend ourselves for the sake of Christ? The good life happens when we totally commit ourselves to God, and when we use whatever power, money, and position we have to serve others. For it is in serving others that we live the good life. We are left with the promise, those who lose their life for my sake will find it. What is happening in Houston is a reminder that there are still people who are willing to sacrifice their lives for the sake of others. In the name of God the Father, God the Son,